But there's a period of time here where there's a potential for some traps for nonprofits to fall into. And so we want to try and help them avoid that.
Welcome to the Solar Energy Channel, where you'll get an honest inside look at all things solar. I'm Warren, and today we have the pleasure of having with me Dale Good, our president and CEO, where we're going to talk about the direct pay or the elective pay feature from the IRA bill that allows nonprofits to take advantage of the tax credits or to get paid back for the tax incentives that come along with installing solar, wind, or other renewables. So welcome, Dale. It's great to have you.
Yeah, good to be here.
Yeah. So before we jump into this, Dale, I just want to throw out a disclaimer here for everybody that we are not tax advisors. When making a large investment, always seek out your professionals, your lawyers, your accountants to give you advice on how to proceed. And also that almost everything that we talk about is based on knowledge that we have as of today, November 16th, 2023. And it's very fluid and it's going to change and get updated. So we'll put out updated information, but this video is recorded as of today's date. And it's the information we know as of today. And then finally, one other piece that I think is important is as it relates to this particular component, the direct pay, there's really not a lot that Paradise does to help our customers get the direct pay. This is really for them and their accountant to do. We can be supportive in providing you with the information that we know. And if you purchase a solar array from us, we can provide you with all of the necessary documentation that you'll need, such as your proposals and paid invoices and agreements and inspections, et cetera. But most of the work to actually file for the registration and file your taxes and do all of that is done on the customer end with them and their accountants. So just know that as we go into this. So with that being said, Dale, why don't you just give us a little bit of background on what is the direct pay and how did it come about and why now?
Yeah, so the direct pay is really a nice feature, Warren, because the previously a nonprofit, somebody who didn't have tax liability was really limited in how they could do renewable energy. It was a PPA, it was a lease. They were working with a third party who could use the tax equity piece, the ITC, the tax credit. And so the direct pay option opened up a new world for nonprofits where they didn't have to do that. And that wasn't always the most profitable route for the nonprofit, but it was their only way to do it. So the direct pay gave them this option where they can take the tax credit amount, which typically went to the third party investor. And that could be 30%, 40%, even 50% or 60%. They can take that tax credit and they can get it refunded to them by the government, even though they don't pay taxes. So that was a dramatic change. It was in the IRA bill of a year ago, a little over a year ago. I think the challenge with the direct pay is that it went into effect on January 1, 2023, but there was no final regulations. There was no final process. There was nothing in place to really guide these nonprofits who some of them were chomping at the bit to take advantage of it, but we didn't really know what was going on. And I think the one thing we can do, Warren, as installers, you know, we're not their accountants, so we're not filing this for them. But there's a period of time here where there's a potential for some traps for nonprofits to fall into. And so we want to try and help them avoid that.
Yeah, absolutely. So let's talk about now, Dale. First of all, before we get into the traps, let's talk about who's eligible. What type of nonprofits?
Yeah, really. I mean, anybody that's a 501c would be available. And then you've got any municipal government entity. I think even a state government entity. There's some Native American situations as well. We don't deal with them personally in our area, but That's typically who it'd be, you know, churches, fire companies, community organizations that are working with their communities, anybody in that category who typically, really, it's anybody that is not, does not have tax equity, doesn't pay taxes. So there were two features in the IRA bill, the transferability of the tax credit and the direct pay. And I think they were aimed, Warren, at getting everybody into the game. So transferability allowed people who were for-profits but may not have had tax equity due to other tax breaks or whatever to take advantage of renewables. That was transferability. The direct pay allowed those who were non-tax equity players who didn't pay taxes to become owners of systems. So that kind of covered the gamut of everybody in the commercial world who might want to go solar.
But you can't, and correct me if I'm wrong, Dale, you cannot match those two. If you are eligible for the direct pay, you can't sell that, or you can't transfer that. I mean, you could give the money away once you receive it, but you can't essentially participate in.
No, absolutely. You're either one or the other. You can't be both.
Yeah. Right, right. And we'll include a link in the description below, but the whitehouse.gov has a great article and a write-up on the direct pay that you can click on a link to see whether or not your nonprofit or whoever you are qualifies for the direct pay. So now let's jump into maybe, Dale, if we can, talk a little bit about the step down and the domestic content requirement and that potential pitfall, and then we'll get into the excessive funding after that.
Well, like other IRA requirements, a lot of them became effective on 1/1/23. So with the domestic content, if a system's under a megawatt on the AC side, it's not a concern. So they're kind of grandfathered in. They don't need to worry about domestic content. They can get the direct pay. If it's a large system over a megawatt, then there are requirements around domestic content going forward. And I'm trying to think exactly what they were. You might know. I think in 2024, it steps down to 90%, and then 2025, it's down to 80%. And then after that, I think it's zero. In other words, you can't get it.
If correct. It's 85% in 2024, and then it steps down.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks for correcting that. But yeah, so that's something to be concerned about. I would suggest, I mean, municipalities would be the ones that probably do those larger systems. A lot of nonprofits would probably be installing systems under a megawatt, typically.
Now let's talk about really quickly the adders, the 10% adders, and whether or not they're eligible for it, nonprofits.
Yeah. So, you know, there's a number of them. You get the domestic content, which is still very unclear. I don't think anybody's taking domestic content right now, or very few. Then you have the energy community, which is the clearest. That's a 10%. Each of these are 10%. And then you have the low-income communities. Now, the low-income one, I think, is an interesting one for nonprofits, because there are some nonprofits operating in low-income neighborhoods who may qualify for that. But that, again, is a completely different process with limits on who, you know, the amount. So some complexity, certainly there's some complexity around trying to file for some of these. Now, the energy community one's an easy one. If you're on the map and you qualify, you're going to get the extra 10%. So instead of 30, you're going to be at 40.
Correct. So just to be clear on for the nonprofits, they are eligible for all three of the other adders, the domestic content, the energy communities, and the low income, if they qualify for those. So they can, in fact, get the direct play plus those adders added on.
Yeah. And I mentioned, Warren, on the low income, there again, we do not file for our clients. That's going to fall to their accountants, and there's a dual process, one with the Department of Energy and one with the IRS. And we are not filing that for clients.
Sure. So now one of the biggest traps or pitfalls that nonprofits could fall into is this excessive funding component that doesn't allow them to either raise funds or receive grants in excess of the amount that they would have to pay. So why don't you talk a little bit about that, Dale?
Yeah. So it's actually the funding of a nonprofit system is really, really important, and it's auditable. So let's say that we have a $100,000 system, and I try and use round numbers. They work easier for me. $100,000 system, and you're going to try and raise some money for it. And let's say you raise $70,000, and it's earmarked for the solar system, and you qualify for a 30% tax credit. And then you get a grant for, say, $20,000 from someplace. So now you've got $70,000, you got $20,000, and you got this $30,000 tax credit. Well, any excessive money that is raised, including grants, above that 70% mark, if you had a 30% tax credit, is gonna reduce your tax credit. In other words, they're not gonna allow you to get over that 100% mark. So it's gonna be donations and grants up to the percentage. If you would go over that 70 and you have a 30% tax credit, then your tax credit's gonna be reduced. And you know, if it's 70% you raised, 20% grant, you'd only get a 10% tax credit. So really important that you track where the money's coming from.
Absolutely. And this only applies if the funding source, whether it's a grant or money that was raised from donations, is specifically earmarked for solar. So if you're trying to raise money for a solar project or you're soliciting grants specifically for a solar project, then this applies to you and something you need to be aware of, because it will reduce the amount of your direct pay.
Yeah, if a nonprofit takes it out of like their operating fund typically, and they're not trying to raise additional money for the solar system, they're probably okay. They're probably fine.
Yeah.
But any earmarked money is what you got to watch.
Yep. So now let's, Dale, jump into if you are, in fact, you know that you are an entity that qualifies for direct pay. You do not have funds that are earmarked for it. So you're safe on that end. And you want to take advantage of this. What are the steps in the process?
Well, they're kind of defined, but they're not. So you have to register your system and you're going to get a number for it. And that's how they're going to track all this stuff. So you got to get that number, and you have to do that before you file your taxes, which is typically 4.5 months after the end of your year. A lot of nonprofits work on calendar years, but some use fiscal years. You've got 4.5 months. And that's when you're going to file a 990-T. Now, we had a church actually recently contact us about this. They were installing a system and they do not file a 990-T. They do not. Some nonprofits are not required to file anything.
Sure.
And they were wondering how to get their tax credit refunded to them. And they clearly have to file the 990-T. If they don't do that, there's no other mechanism to get that refund.
Okay, so, and the White House has a great timeline on their website that you can take a look at. But the first step in the process would be, first of all, to find a qualified installer and get the project installed.
Right.
And the project, the tax credit is for the year that the project goes online. And right. So depending on if you installed a system in 2023 and you file your 990-T or your taxes in the beginning of 2004 for that year, that is when you have to have that registration number by when you do that filing. Right. And according to the White House, the filing and the registration process is going to open up late 2023. We're pretty close to it. It could happen in January or February as well.
Yes, I've seen the number of people who are prognosticating that it's going to be first quarter 2024. So, you know, I don't know, but it hasn't happened yet. It's going to have to happen before April because that's tax filing deadline. So,
yeah, and that's the key piece that the nonprofit needs. They need to get the system installed in the tax year that they're going to use it. Then they need to register and get a registration number, and that registration number, along with the documentation from their solar installer, will allow them to file that with their 990-T. And then sometime months down the line, do you know any indication on how long that process will take until they receive their payment?
No, that's not defined, Warren. I've seen estimates of up to a year or 15 months beyond when they actually file. So that's going to be a gap in funding for any nonprofit. You know, worst case scenario, you install the system in January, the system goes live in January. Okay.
Yeah.
So now you're waiting an entire year and probably 4.5 months to actually file your tax return. And now you're waiting possibly another year until you, or a little more even, until you get the actual money. So potentially you're looking at 2.5 to 3 years, possibly, from when you have to pay the installer until you get reimbursed for the tax credit amount.
Correct. And that can create financing challenges. And we did do a great video, which we'll link in the description as well, with Collective Sun, who have some financing options that are direct pay ready to help get you through the process of getting your system installed until you actually receive that payment from the IRS or the Treasury Department.
Yeah, that's a good point, Warren. And Collective Sun's done I think they've done a really good job of understanding this and helping to guide organizations. They only work with nonprofits, people who qualify for the direct pay type of situation. So they're an excellent source of information.
Yeah. So thank you, Dale. I think in closing, the key piece of information, as we talked about, if you've already had a project installed this year, right now you're probably in a waiting phase for the registration to open up so you can register and get the number and be prepared to file your taxes. If you haven't had a project installed this year, the process is to find a qualified installer, get the project installed. First of all, we'll make sure that you qualify for it. And then at that point, be able to register and file it with your taxes. But to be mindful of the timelines that, as we mentioned, this could string out two and a half years from the time that you install the system till the time that you receive your direct pay payment from the IRS. And also there's a pitfall in when your fiscal year is as a nonprofit, because it's based on your year and when you file taxes. So make sure you're mindful of that. Super. Anything else you'd like to add, Dale?
No, I think it is a great opportunity, though. You know, it's another option for nonprofits to install a renewable system, and I think it can be a really beneficial one. I think it gives them a better return than a lot of leases do, and that a lot of the PPAs do. So, you know, I would encourage them to take a look at it.
Yeah. Super. Well, Dale, thank you very much for your participation today. Really appreciate it.
Thank you, Warren.